I mean, I was
Good afternoon, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ellie Swinson. I've been working here helping out with a few different things. One thing that I love doing is helping build programming for City Club. And I'm so excited this afternoon to welcome Leroy Moore as the first part of a five-part series we have running through this summer. When you sat down, hopefully you saw there was a little card at your place. On the backside, you will find dates and times as well as brief subject headlines for all of the speakers that we're gonna have for this series throughout the summer. So hopefully after this program, you'll be engaged, want to join the conversation and can join us for the rest of our programs. And with that, I actually will hand it over to Harvey to give an introduction for Leroy.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you for being here. You know my obsession with Rocky Flats, and I'm sure you've been very polite in listening to me over the years, but with this series, we can begin to expand commentary, historically accurate and non-political, as far as we can make it, to describe to you what's been going on just 8 miles down the road to the south of here. In the 1970s, I had no idea what was happening at Rocky Flats, and apparently nor did Dr. Leroy Moore. We both thought of, basically in one way or the other, stumbled across this problem. It attracted our interest and we carried on from there. Leroy, from about 1979 onwards, after he got his PhD and came to this area to teach at the University of Denver, realized the significance of this site, this former weapons plant, and has really devoted himself for the last 36 years to the study and the dissemination of material on this problem. So in terms of the outline of schedules here, we've got a little alteration coming up, which we will make clear to you. I'm talking on the 23rd of June on the scientific research that I did out at the flats, and then by the end of July, or in fact July the 4th most probably, we've got scheduled in this room a talk by an Israeli visiting scientist who had extraordinary experiences out at the flats when he worked there, and there will be a chemistry professor also that will fill in the details there. So that will be of extreme importance to the health and safety understanding of this area. Following that, we will go on with with Dr. Gail Biggs, a meteorologist who's done studies out there, and then probably ending up with the FBI agent, John Lipsky, who is still unable to tell us what he found out there because he would be jailed pronto. So there's a lot of it's fascinating, interesting stuff. If you're intrigued at all by seeing this on movies, there are about three movie scripts that are going around, and I think given the fact that Dr. Moore comes originally from Tennessee and then to Texas, I think Clint Eastwood should play you, Leroy, and I'm trying to angle for a person called Benedict Cumberbatch. So okay, without more ado, Dr. Leroy Moore. Thank you.
Thank you, Harvey. I'm an admirer of Harvey Nichols. I think he takes the prize for being the independent scientist who has devoted more years to Rocky Flats than any other since the mid-1970s. So his work is very important. I'm talking today about Rocky Flats overview. I'll give you a kind of chronological look at the Rocky Flats site. The Rocky Flats plant was located 16 miles northwest of central Denver and about 9 miles due south of Boulder, as you can see on this map, right down Highway 93. It was the only plant producing the fissile plutonium pit at the core of each warhead in the U.S. nuclear arsenal. Each pit, in actuality, was itself a plutonium bomb. From 1952, when production began, until it ended in 1989, Rocky Flats produced about 70,000 pits. That's a lot of bombs. Locating the bomb plant at Rocky Flats was actually a fatal mistake because of the wind. The wind blows toward Denver at times severely, with gales up to 100 miles an hour, and more of that, more or less. You know what that's like here in Boulder. It's even stronger at Rocky Flats. They took the wind reading at the old Stapleton Airport, where the wind blew toward the mountains instead of away from the mountains toward the city of Denver. This truck, a picture of this truck, was taken and published in the Rocky Mountain News on Highway 93, right next to the Rocky Flats plant. And actually, this was fate for you, me, and many others. The wind plus the particles of plutonium-239, the principal contaminant at Rocky Flats, there's a great deal of it in the soil there even today. This picture, enlarged 500 times, shows a speck of plutonium in the lung tissue of an ape. This device right here, the star-like form there, is bursts of alpha radiation emitted over 48 hours. Plutonium is harmful only if it is taken into the body. Inhalation is the worst way to be exposed to plutonium. Lodged within, like this picture here shows, lodged in the lung, lodged wherever it lodges in the body, it will continue to irradiate surrounding cells probably for the rest of your life. So it's exceedingly dangerous, much more dangerous than other forms of radiation. And this may result eventually in cancer, a compromised immune system, or genetic harm that can be passed on to future generations. The first period, I'm going to break the Rocky Flats history down into certain periods. The first period, 1952 to 1970, is a time when Rocky Flats was not being closely watched by the public. Most people were totally unaware of what was done at Rocky Flats. Secrecy prevailed behind the veil of security. And in this period were the three worst releases of plutonium, and here they are. The first one was a 1957 fire that released plutonium all the way across the metro area. I'll show you a map later where you can see that. And the second is what is usually referred to as the 903 pad fiasco. There's an area on the outdoors on the site where they stored plutonium in 55-gallon drums, plutonium-laced liquid waste. And that material off in many of those drums leaked into the environment, and then the wind picked it up and distributed it all around, both on and off the site. And this was the worst single release on the site itself. The third major accident that happened in that period was on Mother's Day, a Sunday, 1969, when there was a fire, and it was the largest industrial fire in U.S. history up to that time. And as I will show you in just a moment, this event really was the trigger of public knowledge. Here's an example. I'll give you a couple of examples from this period. This is a picture of firefighters, exhausted firefighters, who finally had succeeded after many hours in putting out the fire that burned in 1957. And these on this side of the picture there, the is the framework for very thick filters, 2 feet by 2 feet by 6 inches. And there are many of them, about 8 feet tall and I don't know how many, 30 some odd feet wide. And that, all the air that was leaving the building, the plutonium processing building, was flowing through there. And those filters were supposed to protect the public. Well, the public wasn't very well protected when the filters were totally destroyed. And the wind went all the way across the metro area, much, including covering much of the, depositing plutonium in much of the city of Denver itself.
Leroy?
Yeah.
You recall, of course, that it was the, for years, those filters have not been changed. And that material, years worth of dust, plutonium dust, blasted out into the environment. Excuse me.
That's right. The production began in 52, and this fire happened in 57, and the filters had not been changed in that whole period. And so, laden with plutonium dust, the wind carried it across the metro area. And this is what is referred to as the 903 pad. It was not a pad originally. The pad was it later when they discovered that these drums stored outdoors for more than a decade leaked plutonium into the environment, and in order to control the plutonium from being picked up by the wind and distributed, they paved over that area, and the pavement is what's called about the size of 2 football fields. That was what was called the 903 pad. So that had been outside there from 1954 till 1969. Period two, from 1970 to 1989, is a time of public awareness. After the 1969 fire, biochemists at the National Center for Environmental Research, Ed Martell, and a colleague of his sampled the off-site environment, and they found plutonium up to several miles from the Rocky Flat site in the environment. And I don't know if the government thought that they could refute Martell by revealing the fact that what he found, they said, didn't come from the Mother's Day fire 69, it came from either the fire in 1957 or it came from releases in the 903 area. And that's how the public learned for the very first time about the three major accidents at Rocky Flats. And Rocky Flats after this time was constantly in the news, and the news was not very pleasing either for the plant or for the public. Carl Johnson was head of the Jefferson County Health Department, and he did a lot of important work, but he's best known for a study that he did that was published in 1981. It was a study of where plutonium had gone in the off-site environment, and here you can see that some deposits of plutonium had gone across the whole of the city of Denver to the far side, and these others had a heavier deposit of plutonium had come into Denver, and sort of the middle level had gone into the downtown central part of the city. The most contaminated, what he then showed, after he shows the levels of contamination, he showed he looked up the official record of cancer incidents in the period 1969 to 1971, and he found that there was 16% more cancer in zone one, this area, darker red, than there was in the non-contaminated zone four, which surrounds that. And there was 10% more cancer in zone 2, and there was 6% more cancer in zone 3.
So, Leroy?
Yeah.
For the Table Mesa moms here, is Boulder in zone 4?
Boulder is not on his map. It's Boulder is upwind, and though we can't say that there was no plutonium in Boulder that came from Rocky Flats, there undoubtedly is some, but the primary wind pattern is shown on this map, blowing east and southeast from the site. So it's the people that live in that area that have the most, that have a right to be concerned about the plutonium in their environment. Nothing has ever been done to clean or remove the plutonium in the offsite areas.
Steve is right though. With the swirling patterns of up and downslope winds in this area and the inversion, stuff will have got into, as you say, Leroy, will have got into Boulder, but to a lesser degree than this.
Yeah, Boulder's not totally free, but we don't usually show up on these maps because the deposits here are very small by comparison with other areas. And this period that I'm talking about was also the time of growing resistance to activities at Rocky Flats. Here's a photograph of people that were part of the Rocky Flats Truth Force, which occupied the railway tracks leading into the Rocky Flats plant. In 1989, it's often referred to as the Year of Disobedience. It was, so far as I know, the longest sustained civil disobedience activity in the United States. If you were sitting on the tracks and you were arrested and removed, within a short time, others would come and take the place that you had vacated. And many people were arrested repeatedly. Patrick Malone, who grew up in Denver and now lives in Atlanta, was arrested a total of 10 times. This is the first arrest. And this is this man with a cowboy hat is Daniel Ellsberg, who was famous for releasing the Pentagon Papers, and he was a participant in the Rocky Flats Truth Force. Another picture of resistance activity. This on the 15th of October 1983, about 17,000 people encircled the whole Rocky Flat plant. And this picture is taken at the northeast corner. This Highway 93 would be right behind these people, and it meets the road that comes across from the northern side of the Rocky Flats plant. I think that's called Highway 128.
128, yeah.
And this is very near the intersection of 93 and 128. Period 3, 1989 to 92, very short period by comparison to the others. And I refer to it as the limbo, no production. And it ended with the change of mission from production to cleanup. The FBI raided the plant in June 1989 to collect evidence of environmental lawbreaking at the plant itself. Production was temporarily halted, and it was never resumed. Efforts to restart the plant failed at just the time the Soviet Union collapsed and the Cold War ended. In 1992, the Department of Energy changed the Rocky Flats mission from production to cleanup. Meanwhile, the court case that had been brought against Rockwell International, the company that was running the plant, after the FBI raid, was settled with a plea bargain, an out-of-court settlement. Major charges against the company were dropped. Most famous was that they were burning plutonium illegally in an incinerator. If you lived around here, you might remember that. The company admitted guilt for less serious offenses, paid a fine, and received immunity from further prosecution. And from this period, I draw you the example of the rebellious Rocky Flats grand jury. The judge who made the deal with Rockwell dissolved the grand jury that had spent nearly 3 years reviewing evidence collected in the raid. The jurors refused to be dissolved until they prepared a report that called Rocky Flats an ongoing criminal enterprise. This never happened any time else in U.S. judicial history that a grand jury actually refused to go home until they could write a report explaining why they thought they should continue. But they called Rocky Flats an ongoing criminal enterprise, and they sought indictment. They wanted to put several Department of Energy and Rockwell officials on trial. Not the ordinary workers, but the people in charge, the ones that were making the actual decisions. Their report was ignored in the settlement, and all evidence from the case was sealed. And the evidence remains sealed to this day. And if you want to get the details of it, I highly recommend you're taking a look at the book, The Ambush Grand Jury, How the Justice Department Covered Up Government Nuclear Crimes and How We Caught Them Red-Handed. You'll have John Lipsky talking to you later. He led the FBI raid, and he also is a featured person in the book, The Ambush Grand Jury.
Leroy, it's worth remembering for the audience that those people of the grand jury risked jail if they spoke about what they'd found out. And that still applies to this day, to the end of their lives. Not even congressional people with Q clearance are allowed to listen to them.
Period four, the next period, begins in 1992. The mission changed to cleanup, and this is the time for the cleanup and closure. The Department of Energy contractor and the contractor at the plant, Kaiser Hill, announced in 1995 that they would leave most of the on-site contamination in place and cover it over with soil and rock, and the public let them know very quickly, a loud no, that they wouldn't accept that. So they started over, and I was part of a group that was created to make a recommendation about what we wanted at the Rocky Flat site, the future site use working group. And we recommended that the site be cleaned to average background level, which for plutonium is 0.04 picocuries per gram of soil. A picocurie is a very small amount of measure of radiation, but a little bit of plutonium is exceedingly dangerous. The 0.04 picocuries is not part of natural background radiation. It's part of the background because as a result of global detonation of nuclear weapons in various places, fallout plutonium. The Department of Energy, the EPA, and the Colorado Department of Health and Environment rejected this recommendation and eventually adopted a three-level standard for cleanup. The top 3 feet would be cleaned to 50 picocuries per gram. That's a whole lot more than 0.04 picocuries per gram. The plutonium at the depth of 3 to 6 feet would be cleaned to somewhere between 1,000 and 7,000 picocuries per gram. And then below 6 feet, there's no limit on the amount of plutonium that can remain in the environment.
And how did he clean that?
There's considerable amount.
How do you clean that much dirt?
Well, they removed it, they dug it up and moved the dirt to another location. They didn't get rid of the plutonium, they took it to another location.
Wow.
They can't get rid of it, and a lot of it remains in the environment.
So where did they take it?
They took, that material was taken either to to the Nevada test site, in near Las Vegas, where there's a lot of radioactive stuff dumped, along with all the remains of having bombs there. Or they took it to a place in Utah, west of Salt Lake City, where so-called low-level radioactive waste is deposited. So one of those two locations. The Superfund cleanup, according to the laws, Superfund law, the Superfund cleanup must protect the person that is determined to be the maximally exposed individual. And the agencies responsible for the cleanup said that is a wildlife refuge worker at Rocky Flats. They cleaned the site to produce a wildlife refuge, and they made the erroneous assumption that the wildlife refuge worker would be the maximally exposed individual. But plutonium will be in the soil and will be dangerous far longer than the existence of the U.S. government or the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. So they didn't begin to carry out the mandate of the Superfund law. Well, here are a couple of pictures. Rocky Flats appeared at the height of production, and as the site appears after production, after cleanup, when all of the buildings have been removed from the site, and plutonium is still in the environment, invisible, but it's there and it's still dangerous. That picture up there, I wanted you to see the area on the right-hand side of the manufacturing part of the plant looks like a road, but it's not a road. It's a high security area, and that is the what's called the hot side, where the plutonium processing was done, and the cold side is on the left side of that, where work with stainless steel and other metals were done, also producing parts for bombs. This is the way the site looks now, though the grass has begun to grow back there in that area. Period 5, 2007 and following. 2007 is when the declaration was made that the cleanup had been finished, and the EPA certified that the cleanup was done. And the Department of Energy retained more than 2 square miles of land in the central part of the industrial area, the most contaminated part of the site. They retained it for their own uses, and they continued to do some monitoring there. As I say here, well, a couple of things. That DOE land, Department of Energy land, is still on the EPA Superfund list. And the land that is now part of the Rocky Flats Wildlife Refuge, that land has been removed from the Superfund list. The only monitoring that's now done on the site is by the Department of Energy on Department of Energy land. And here the only thing they monitor is surface water and groundwater. They no longer make any effort to monitor the air.
And the state's not involved at all? It's all federal?
What?
The state of Colorado is not involved in that monitoring?
The state does monitor it, yes. On behalf of the EPA, the state has a strict requirement for plutonium in surface water, and it monitors it where the water is leaving the site. That's the primary thing that the state does. They're not doing air monitoring either, or anything other than groundwater or surface water monitoring. Yeah.
Do you consider the movement being?
She's wondering if you can distinguish between the transport of the plutonium by wind versus water in terms of seriousness, and I would guess that's a very difficult question to answer.
That's a difficult question to answer because, thank you. It is a difficult question to answer, but it's a very good question. And the plutonium certainly moves both ways. It moves in water, and it can be picked up by the wind. The cleanup, when they did the cleanup, they assumed that most of the plutonium in the environment would stay in place, that there'd be very little migration of it. But animals, even earthworms, bring whatever is in the soil, they bring it to the surface. And if they bring it to the surface, the water can take it away, or the wind can pick it up and distribute it, you know, who knows where. Distribute it on the refuge, which supposedly is clean. There was never any cleanup activity on the refuge. It only happened in the interior part where the Department of Energy land, retained by the Department of Energy. At one of the Department of Energy sampling sites, and this is not a state sampling site, but a Department of Energy sampling site, plutonium in surface water routinely exceeds the state's strict standard. But since it's not leaving the site, it's on the site, the state doesn't do anything about it. It's what's called a point of evaluation, not a point of compliance. A point of compliance is where the state monitors the stuff, and if it exceeds the state standard, then DOE is subject, they have to do some kind of corrective action, or they might even have to pay a fine. But there's one place on the site where plutonium keeps showing up in excess of the state standard, and they can't locate the plutonium, so they can't do anything about it. At the peak of the flood in September 2013, the Department of Energy's water sampling equipment did not work. So, and in addition to that, a lot of the flooding that happened in 2013 at Rocky Flats was not down the streams, through the stream beds, but it was overland. There was so much water that was just flowing over the land and carrying who knows what with it. That material was never sampled, so that nobody really knows what what left the site at that time.
Well, Christy Everson, in her book Full Body Burden, which I think many have read, she indicated there's a lot of spillover in Stanley Lake down in Arvada.
Yeah, that's right. The Department of Energy did have to pay for a diversion of water. So since 2000, or I forget the exact year, when there's a special reservoir that was built that diverts water away from Stanley Lake, so any water flowing from the Rocky Flats site can no longer go to Stanley Lake. Stanley Lake is a water source for several of the suburban cities.
But it goes somewhere, so how can anybody say that it's
The EPA has found plutonium in the sediment, and the EPA, contrary to what happens to lakes everywhere, says that the plutonium stays in place and it doesn't get stirred around in the water. I suspect it does get stirred around in the water.
That's a very intriguing aspect. You can believe or not believe, but there's evidence.
You have good questions, and most of them are unanswerable. Here's a picture. Where is it? Here it is. That's myself standing alongside the a trench or a ditch along Indiana Street. That's the north-south road that runs right along the edge of the Rocky Flat site. And this picture was taken about 9 months after the flood, and you can see all the debris that is remaining there in the ditch. And of course nobody knows what really is there, what radioactivity, what plutonium or anything else might have been carried there off the plant site, or even then moved considerably further away.
Has anybody tried to measure the radiation?
Well, it hasn't been officially done. We have taken some samples from the Rocky Mountain Peace and Justice Center. We have collected some samples since the flood and sent them to a scientist in Boston who analyzes them for us. And indeed, we found plutonium at several of the locations along Indiana Street, not further away, just right there on the edge of the site. So, but the government has never asked us for that evidence. We haven't hidden it from them, but they don't ask for it. This map I want to show you because the white area in the central part there is the Department of Energy land, the area they retain, a little more than 2 square miles, and the green part surrounding it is the Fish and Wildlife, Rocky Flats National Wildlife Refuge. And this is Indiana Street right here, where we have collected samples, and the streams that flow through there, cross that's beneath that street.
And Leroy, that Indiana Street is where the Jefferson Parkway,
yeah,
a really major highway, is going to be put in if they succeed.
I'll show that again in a moment. My friend Bob Del Chatterjee, some of you have already met him. He's been here and he'll be back fairly soon. But he drew this wonderful cartoon showing the Department of Energy passing the torch. The Rocky Flats, the radioactive torch is being passed to Fish and Wildlife, and the animals there don't seem very happy about what's happening. This map, am I right here? I think I am. This map shows the contamination near Rocky Flats. This map was made by Atomic Energy Commission scientists back in 1970, and it was used a few years ago when there was a major court case brought on behalf of people that lived in that area, that their property values had been harmed by contamination from Rocky Flats. But you can see on this map the dotted red line. I can't seem to tell that my little light is showing, but that dotted red line that runs right along Indiana Street and then angles over to Highway 93 is the route that is proposed for the Jefferson Parkway. And the proposed highway, as you can see, traverses very highly contaminated area right on the edge of the site. And construction would stir up plutonium in that area. Store up a lot of it, undoubtedly. And this road may actually never be built because they cannot use state or federal taxes to build the road. And they must raise money from private parties. And so far, the controversy about the highway and about Rocky Flats seems to be scaring investors away. They don't seem to be eager to invest in building a highway in that area. So the road may go down because they don't raise the investments that they must. Yeah.
So the new development along 93, if we go back to that plutonium contamination map,
yes. Yeah.
Is that outside of your colored areas? Are they digging up plutonium to build people's basements?
The area where the big major construction is happening, can you see that Highway 72? Mm-hmm. It comes down from Coal Creek Canyon and runs south of the Rocky Flat site and goes off this way. The area between Highway 72 and the dotted black line, which is the southern boundary of Rocky Flats, is where the Candelas development is now being built. You can buy a spectacular house for a lot of money if you want to do it. and live right next there. And maybe 20 feet from your back door will be the fence, and on the other side of that is the Rockefeller site. It's that close. But this there's an area over here called, right where that dark area is, it's called Whisper Creek. It's another housing development that's several years older than Candelas. It all the houses are built and occupied. I think they're all finished and occupied by this time. And it's far more contaminated than the Candelas area, according to this map. Candelas, I won't say it's not contaminated at all, and it's always subject to windblown stuff. If they're releasing stuff on site, it can blow into the area at Candelas. But Whisper Creek is definitely more contaminated, and that's another beautiful place where you can live on a hill and have a wonderful view. You can see the mountains. You can look across the uninhabited Rocky Flat site.
Perfect place for an old folks home.
So, the latency period is 15 to 20 years, so you're dead right.
You people are good with questions. A few years ago, I thought I'd get some, when they were creating the Rocky Flats Wildlife Refuge, I would get some people to draw cartoons. So I sent out a message to people all over the country, and a guy in Atlanta sent me a couple of cartoons, and this is one of his. His name is Tom Ferguson. He clearly thinks that the greatest danger at Rocky Flats is plutonium. So there's his image of the danger of plutonium. And that's the primary contaminant at Rocky Flats. He drew another cartoon that he sent me showing what Fish and Wildlife hopes they can do. They can attract school kids to make field trips onto the Rocky Flats Refuge. And of course, it's clean as a whistle. So who worries about it? Tom is vexed by the question, should the public visit a radioactive site?
What about drinking water?
Drinking water.
Where does the different supplies of drinking water come from if you're in Golden versus Boulder?
I mentioned a while ago that the water flowing from the Rocky Flat site into Stanley Lake is now diverted, and it has been for about 15 years, I think, so that no contamination from Rocky Flats any longer flows into Stanley Lake, and that's a primary water source for Westminster, North Glen, and parts of Arvada. Western Reservoir is on a different creek that flows from Rocky Flats, and they did find radioactive material in that tritium. That's a radioactive material that we don't hear much of, but they found tritium, and it came from Rocky Flats, and it was in the Great Western Reservoir, and the town of Broomfield made a lot of noise about it because that's their primary drinking water source. And finally, they forced the Department of Energy, who never admitted that they'd done anything wrong, but they forced them to pay for a pipeline that would bring water to them from the Boulder water supply into Broomfield, so that they no longer get drinking water from Great Western Reservoir. They use water from Great Western Reservoir to irrigate parks and things like that, parkways in the town of Broomfield, but they don't drink that water.
Could I offer a little reassurance just on this one point? One of the least dangerous ways of ingesting this material is just orally. It passes right through within 12 or 24 hours. So that's one of the nice things about it. So drink up.
Excuse me.
Yeah, yeah, there are a lot of hands going up. I'm not going to get finished. Go ahead.
Okay, I just want to make sure it's me. I was just curious, was there ever, with these home developments that went up near Rocky Flats, was there any effort made by any public outreach or anything to consumers who would be possibly buying there?
There is a group that was started by a group of women. There's an organization called Candelas Glows. And people from that organization actually show up at Candelas about once a month, usually on a Sunday, and there might be as many as 25 or 30 of them. And they can't be arrested as long as they stay on public land. If they're on the sidewalk, they will not be arrested. If they start going into homes or into the display houses, that sort of thing, they might be arrested. But they bring attention to it.
That's true, because as a mom...
So far as I know, there's been nothing like that at Whisper Creek. The Whisper Creek is more contaminated. So, good question. Well, there was another one back there somewhere.
No. Was there a study done after the flood as far as rechanneling the water flows, the natural water channels changing since the flood? I know we live up in the Chautauqua area and the actual groundwater has definitely changed the channels.
You understand that question, Harvey?
Has there been a study as far as whether that it's different now? The flow is, I know you mentioned something above ground.
Basically, it's another one of those questions that's really hard to answer, that the post-flood realignment of the channels and so forth, has that been studied?
Not to my knowledge. These are good questions, and you should ask that. You should address a letter to the head of the DOE and ask him if they've done that and when they're going to do that.
Hard to mitigate if you don't
when.
Know. Yeah.
Because they should do it, but that hasn't been done. And he will probably tell you that DOE doesn't do anything in off-site environment anymore. So it's only what happens on the site that they're concerned about. Wes McKinley, who chaired that runaway Rocky Flats grand jury, is forbidden to tell you what he knows from his study of environmental conditions at Rocky Flats. He got elected to the Colorado State Legislature in hopes that he would be able to do something about Rocky Flats. And then while he was in the legislature, he made repeated efforts. And both Harvey and I testified when he was trying to get the legislature to require the state to post signs at entries to the wildlife refuge informing potential visitors that going on to the refuge might expose them to radioactive material. His efforts were opposed by the State Health Department, CDPHE, Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment. They were opposed by Mark Udall, who was then our senator, and they were opposed by the Rocky Flats Stewardship Council, which is a DOE-funded oversight body that still exists, and in fact will have its next meeting next Monday. So some of these good questions could be raised at the Stewardship Council. It's about the only place now where there's an opportunity to raise questions to government people about what's happening at Rocky Flats. Well, the wind still blows. And this picture was taken on the 17th of July, 2010, and it just happened that Bob Del Tredici and I went out there quite by accident on the very day that they started moving dirt to build Candelas, and there's the big pile of dirt, and it was a windy day. And that dust, you can be quite assured, is carrying some plutonium who knows where.
That's not going to Denver, that's going north.
So, I'm 82 years old. I can afford to take a deep breath of that stuff. I'm not going to be around long enough to get cancer. I'll say a little bit about burns. In 2000, the Department of Energy wanted to burn 500 acres on the Rocky Flat site to prevent wildfires. Due to a lot of public opposition, including here in Boulder, they reduced the size to 50 acres. And on April 1st of that year, when the burn occurred, a plume of smoke carrying plutonium passed over much of the metro area. And the Department of Energy, after that, dropped plans for any more burns. They said they would leave it to Fish and Wildlife, who will come along later. Burnable plants and debris accumulated on the site, and there were wildfires occasionally. Also, invasive vegetation drove out native plants, such as the xeric tall grass, very unusual now. There's very little of it left in the North American continent, and the biggest stand of that kind of grass is on the Rocky Flat site, only because there was no development there for such a long time. Fish and Wildlife plans to address this situation in its customary way with prescribed burns. It proposed to burn 701 acres in the southwest area of the refuge, just across the fence from Candelas in the spring of this year. But there was a lot of opposition to it, and on the 29th of January, they announced that they would not do the burn. It was being canceled. But that doesn't mean they're going to end it. They want to come back and do it.
What about the goats?
Well, that's one of the things. This slide talks about the alternatives, that the things that need to be done. There are three permanent problems to address. Invasive plants must be culled, perhaps with beetles. There is a beetle that can be put in the plant and it will stop the plant from reproducing itself, an invasive plant. And they must shorten the grass so it can't mow. And here's where the goats might come in handy, either mowing the grass to keep it short or taking goats there and let the goats graze it down.
Thanks, Harvey. Anyway,
the plutonium in the environment should not be released. We've been pressing Fish and Wildlife to sit down and talk with informed people about the alternatives, the things that they can do that they so far haven't said they would do to deal with the invasive plants and the possibility of wildfires on the plant. So I hope that we get to have that kind of conversation. It hasn't happened yet. Period 7, from 2011 till now, is Rocky Flats nuclear guardianship. Nuclear guardianship means taking responsibility for the radioactive material that we humans have introduced onto this planet, and that is very dangerous to us and to other creatures. And it is based on the recognition that materials like plutonium pose a danger essentially forever. So it's not something short that you can do today and forget about. We've got to educate a generation of people to educate the next generation and pass the responsibility on from one generation to the next to take care of this material. This was created in 2011. It prepares present and future generations for the time when at Rocky Flats, fences fall and memories fade. Rocky Flats Nuclear Guardianship asked the question, what about Gabriel? And here he is, a child, eating flowers, which could be sprinkled with dust containing plutonium. and so on. We need to take care of him. Terry Tempest Williams, who grew up downwind of the Nevada test site and has had surgery several times because of that exposure, and is a major writer on these themes. Her statement, the eyes of the future are looking back at us, and they are praying for us to see beyond our own time. Good. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Are we going to take more questions, or are we done?
Yeah, formally we end. Some people may have to leave, but I want to just dive in for a quick second. I didn't take the time to mention that there's a very fine periodical monograph here called Citizen's Guide to Rocky Flats that was authored primarily by Dr. Moore. And I used to use this in a critical thinking class. And he has a very wise word in the introduction. It says, to the reader, this work is dense with detail, much of it painful. Please take it in small doses. It can be very difficult to understand how this can be allowed to go ahead, I think. And yet, one more plug here for a congressional report. This is one of two volumes. You see how thick it is. The Volpe report, Congressman W-O-L-P-E, Volpe. It's entitled Environmental Crimes at the Rocky Flats Nuclear Weapons Facility. That's an official congressional document, and it's full of incredible detail.